there. I'm going to read it down here. But together we're going to say it. So our vision statement is a world powerfully transformed through shared spiritual awakening. And then our mission statement, advancing the movement of spiritual awakening and transformation through unity, a positive path for spiritual living. And our values, abundance, acceptance, community, diversity, integrity, joy, and love. And together we celebrate our children. Unity of Appleton sees the divinity in all children and nurtures their unfolding spirituality. And now we have a song. After I read the daily word.
Right.
You see what I mean? Okay. All is well, believe it or not. Okay. May 1st. Isn't that exciting? May 1st. And the subject is joy. The word for the day is I carry joy in my heart. My many happy experiences and memories may lead me to feel joyful, but I know that they are not the source of my joy. One of my divine gifts, joy is part of my spiritual identity, as close to me as my next breath. Joy wells up and spills over within me when I bring my awareness to my spiritual nature and to my oneness with all good and all life. It's an attitude I hold in mind and a feeling in my heart. The happiness I feel in life depends on my allowing my inner wellspring of joy to come forth. I nurture my joy by maintaining a regular prayer practice that enhances my awareness of God and by making time for the things that make me happiest. I go into the world grateful for the joy that resides within me, my gift to share generously. And from Isaiah, "For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace." Okay. Now we have music.
Yes.
Okay. And
take care of us.
earth is our mother. She will take care of us. The earth is our mother. She will take care of us. Hey, yana, ho, yana.
All right, I get to introduce Linda Duesterhoeft, who is going to be our speaker this morning. Linda, too, is a longtime member of Unity of Appleton. She grew up on a dairy farm near Waupaca and later Winnebago County. You know what? I have to go get my glasses. Linda first hiked and squirrel hunted. I didn't know that about my friend Linda. Okay, so Linda hiked and squirrel hunted the hickory woods with her father when she couldn't even hold a cork gun. When he died in a farm accident, she was 6 years old. Her mother moved their family of three to a small cottage in Winneconne. Linda has known the love and loss and healing of family, land, and the farming lifestyle. She is here today to share the joy of having an intimate connection with the land, flora, and fauna on this May Day. And here is Linda Duesterhoeft.
Thank you. Thank you, Emily. It's always exciting to be here. It's so exciting. I get nervous. So let's see. So if you could go to the next slide, please. Earth Care Vision, if you could say this aloud with me. All humanity lives in a spiritual consciousness that manifests loving coexistence with all creation and care for our Earth family. And our next slide. I have here For the Love of Patience, and it's sort of my joke because on growing up Catholic, we would always, you know, do collections to save the pagan babies, and I've kind of grown up to become one. And so I've renamed this actually for the love of creation. I think I have it off. For the love of creation, loving the creation today, we're going to do this. Hi there, you guys. With poets, pagans, prayer, and plants. So thank you, Emily, for starting us out with magical, mystical, mysterious May, or magical May. And here we are with poets, pagans, prayers, and plants. This is May Day, and I researched. When I was a little kid, we did, you know, going around the maypole and so on. I'm like, where did that come from? Well, this is like really ancient paganism out of Germany is where they're thinking it came from, where they would dance around a live tree to celebrate the return of spring. The Celtic folks in Ireland and Europe, they believed that May 1st actually was the first day of summer because it's an astronomical point which is halfway between the spring equinox and the summer solstice. We have this religion, in broad terms, called many things. Neo-paganism, like new paganism, modern paganism, ethnic religions, native face. So it can be any. So academics, particularly in here in our North America, considered modern paganism a form of nature religion. And religious studies scholar Dr. characterizes paganism as representing a profound and meaningful religious world view. Should be revitalized in our modern world. I'm going to read for you three poems that I wrote regarding my love of the creation. Now, if it helps to take in these words, I invite you to close your eyes and try to have an open heart. The first one is called, Have You Ever? Have you ever pressed your face against the sweet scent of a newborn baby? Or held your lover's hand for long, tender hours in a darkened theater? Or even known you could love a hand, the taper and length of fingers, the shape of the index, the slope of the thumb? Have you ever cupped your palms around the velvet muzzle of a mare's nose, inhaled her hay-sweet breath on a frosty morning? Have you ever stretched arms and legs and back against a summer's meadow on a moonless night and felt yourself shrink to the size of an ant under a quadrillion stars and Cassiopeia? Have you ever lived in a kiss, as if gently, slowly drinking and never getting full, and drinking and drinking? Have you learned to do one thing perfectly? A blueberry pie, a vegetable stew, a wrinkle-free bed, a stitch in time. This next poem is short, but it's a time of loss and love and longing and love and beauty. It's called Mending Fences, which I did when I was 10 years old with my father. Mending fences. I helped mend fences one spring after a thunderstorm ripped the blossoms off our snowball bush. Found a nest of wet, naked robin chicks sucking the sky for their mama. I cried that they might die. When autumn came that year, my father's eyes sank into dark furrows as his body thinned. We sold the farm in spring. They say you can never go back home. It is past. But I want to. I want a job as important as priming the watering trough pump for the cows to drink, herding them home for milking, and taking care of sick things. And this next one is the bridge into from Christianity, making friends with pagans. A Christian makes peace with her inner pagan. This is the last poem. Christianity celebrates Easter, the first Sunday after the first full moon, after the vernal equinox, the resurrection of Jesus. When I was a child, seated in the pews of St. Mary's on Sundays, bookended by my mother and father, wiggling with the impatient waiting for the important job of dropping the dollar into the collection basket, a donation to save the pagan babies, so they might know the Son of God. As I reconnoiter the space between then and now, I celebrate a host of resurrections. The return of the sun, when days grow longer and nights grow shorter, when tree sap flows upward ascendant, the brave push of the crocus through leaf and snow, robins return north, my jubilant heart rising on the wings of bird song arpeggios. This morning, Emily was talking about the sounds of nature. And when you're outside in spring, now, I hope you've noticed how the air is moist with bird song. So. So we are in this place of needing to learn how to better take care of the earth. And who else is better equipped to teach us that than Native Americans? And a friend of mine loaned me her book, Braiding Sweetgrass, written by Robin Wall Kimmerer, who is a mother, a scientist, a decorated professor, and she is an enrolled member of the Citizen Potawatomi Nation. She talks about the cosmology of the indigenous people. Our cosmology is Adam and Eve. We know this story. And she's going to compare the two cosmologies and how that affects us. But I'll give you a little heads up of generally what I've learned so far. And that is that in the cosmology of the indigenous people, they consider all animals, all plants, all insects to be their brothers, their sisters, their teachers. And that humans came onto the scene last, and we are the youngest. And so they turn to their elders, like, whoa, for wisdom. So I'm going to read the cosmology story about that. So in winter, when the green earth lies resting beneath a blanket of snow, this is the time for storytelling. The storytellers begin by calling upon those who came before, who passed the stories down to us, for we are only messengers. In the beginning, there was the sky world. She fell like a maple seed, pirouetting on an autumn breeze. A column of light streamed from a hole in the sky world, marking her path where only darkness had been before. It took her a long time to fall. In fear or maybe hope, she clutched a bundle tightly in her hand. Hurtling downward, she saw only dark water below. But in that emptiness, there were many eyes gazing up at the sudden shaft of light. They saw there a small object, a mere dust mote in the beam. As it grew closer, they could see that it was a woman, arms outstretched, long black hair billowing behind her as she spiraled toward them. The geese nodded at one another and rose together from the water in a wave of goose music. She felt the beat of their wings as they flew beneath to break her fall. Far from the only home she'd ever known, she caught her breath at the warm embrace of soft feathers as they gently carried her downward. And so it began. The geese could not hold the woman above the water for much longer, so they called a council to decide what to do. Resting on their wings, she saw them all gather loons, otters, swans, beavers, fish of all kinds. A great turtle floated in their midst and offered his back for her to rest upon. Gratefully, she stepped from the goose wings onto the dome of his shell. The others understood that she needed land for her home and discussed how they might serve her need. The deep divers among them had heard of mud at the bottom of the water and agreed to go find some. Loon dove first, but the distance was too far, and after a long while he surfaced and had nothing to show for his efforts. One by one, the other animals offered to help. Otter, beaver, sturgeon. But the depth, the darkness, and the pressures were too great for even the strongest of the swimmers. They returned gasping for air with their heads ringing. Some did not return at all. Soon, only little muskrat was left, the weakest diver of all. He volunteered to go while the others looked on doubtfully. His small legs flailed as he worked his way downward, and he was gone a very long time. They waited and waited for him to return, fearing the worst for their relative, and before long a stream of bubbles rose with a small, limp body of the muskrat. He had given his life to aid this helpless human. But then the others noticed that his paw was tightly clenched, and when they opened it, there was a small handful of mud. The turtle said, "Here, put it on my back, and I will hold it." Sky Woman bent and spread the mud with her hands across the shell of the turtle. Moved by the extraordinary gifts of the animals, she sang in thanksgiving and then began to dance, her feet caressing the earth. The land grew and grew as she danced her thanks from the dab of mud on Turtle's back until the whole earth was made. Not by Sky Woman alone, but from the alchemy of all the animals' gifts, coupled with her deep gratitude. Together they formed what we know today as Turtle Island, our home. Like any good guest, Sky Woman had not come empty-handed. The bundle was still clutched in her hand. When she toppled from the hole in the sky world, she had reached out to grab onto the tree of life that grew there. In her grasp were branches, fruits, and seeds of all kinds of plants. These she scattered onto the new ground and carefully tended each one until the world turned from brown to green. Sunlight streamed through the hole from the sky world. Sky world allowing the seeds to flourish. While grasses, flowers, trees, medicines spread everywhere. And now that the animals too had plenty to eat, many came to live with her on Turtle Island. I'd never heard that story until, thank you, Robin Wall Kimmerer, for sharing that with me and now with all of you. So she's a professor. I think she's in New York. I'm sorry, Robin, I don't know where you teach. And so she was talking to her class, and this is how one of her mornings went. Just two more paragraphs. On Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays at 9:35 a.m., I am usually in a lecture hall at the university, expounding about botany and ecology, trying in short to explain to my students how Sky Woman's gardens known by some as global ecosystems, function. One otherwise unremarkable morning, I gave the students in my general ecology class a survey. Among other things, they were asked to rate their understanding of the negative interactions between humans and the environment. Nearly every one of the 200 students said confidently that humans and nature are a bad mix. These were third-year students who had selected a career in environmental protection, so the response was, in a way, not very surprising. They were well-schooled in the mechanics of climate change, toxins in the land and water, and the crisis of habitat loss. Later in the survey, they were asked to rate their knowledge of positive interactions between people and the land. Their median response was none. I was stunned. How is it possible that in 20 years of education, they cannot think of any beneficial relationships between people and the environment? Perhaps the negative examples they see each day, brown fields, you know, all plowed up. Factory farms, suburban sprawl, truncated their ability to see some good between humans and the earth. As the land becomes impoverished, so too does the scope of their vision. When we talked about this after class, I realized that they could not even imagine what beneficial relations between their species and others might look like. How can we begin to move toward ecological and cultural sustainability if we cannot even imagine what the path feels like? If we can't imagine the generosity of geese? These students were not raised on the story of Sky Woman. In our Zoom today, we'll be hearing from Fred, who tuned in to an Academy of Arts and Science and Letters, where a group have gotten together that includes indigenous peoples and governments and academic people and citizens from Michigan, Wisconsin, and Minnesota to create an adaptation to what's happening in our climate. So stick around for the Zoom, and Fred's going to share some of that. Well, what about Eve? Okay. So on the other side was another woman with a garden and a tree. But for its tasting of fruit, she was banished from the garden, and the gates clanged shut behind her. That mother of men was made to wander in the wilderness and earn her bread by the sweat of her brow, not by filling her mouth with the sweet, juicy fruits that bend the branches low. In order to eat, she was instructed to subdue the wilderness into which she was cast. Same species, same earth, different stories. Like creation stories everywhere, cosmologies are a source of identity and orientation to the world. They tell us who we are. We are inevitably shaped by them, no matter how distant they may be from our consciousness. One story leads to the generous embrace of the living world, the other to banishment. One woman is our ancestral gardener, a co-creator of the good green world that would be the home of her descendants. The other was an exile, just passing through an alien world on a rough road to her real home in heaven. And then they met, the offspring of Sky Woman and the children of Eve. And the land around us bears the scars of that meeting, the echoes of our stories. They say that hell hath no fury like a woman scorned, and I can only imagine the conversation between Eve and Sky Woman. Sister, you got the short end of the stick. So, that. Thank you, Robin. It seems to me that if we want to learn how to take care of our earth, the indigenous people are the ones to turn to learn. Let's see. Earlier this week, Cindy sent a link to Reverend Lisa Herkholz's blog. And she's with Great Lake Unity Region, and she writes a blog, and she did this in honor of May Day. And it's called Nature Surely, the Glorified Face of God. So I'm going to take this and work it as sort of a meditative prayer for all of us here right now and at home. So if you could get comfortable in your seats and move into a prayer-centered awareness. If you care to, you can close your eyes. And here are Reverend Lisa Herkholz's words. The spiritual journey we take is one of remembering. We take it because we have forgotten. In our forgetfulness, we have lived believing we are disconnected, one to the other and from our natural world. We have confused abundance with amassing for ourselves and by taking from another. We have confused power with having control over and subordinating others and nature. Now, in this moment, we walk each other home. We awaken with awareness that abundance is achieved through generosity. Power is gained by empowering others. And true joy is found when the love that flows through all living things is respected, honored, and acknowledged. Thich Nhat Hanh has said, quote, we need a real awakening, enlightenment, to change our way of thinking and seeing things, to breathe in and be aware of one's body and look deeply into it. Realize you are the earth, and your consciousness is also the consciousness of the earth. End of quotes. Journeys require change. They require we release old thoughts, old ways, old habits. It takes our commitment to learn, to become aware of what is needed, to act boldly, and to be willing to invite in new ways of being with each other and with our natural resources. Think of someone you love dearly. Feel how that love swells in your heart. What would you be willing to do to support them to become all that they are meant to be? Now feel that same love for the planet and the animals. Nature nurtures us every day. Trust in your love to nurture nature in return. Unity co-founder Charles Fillmore has said, quote, when love, the universal magnet, is brought into action in the consciousness of our human race, it will change all our methods of supplying human wants. It will harmonize all the forces of nature and will dissolve the discords that infest earth and air. The earth shall be yet made paradise by the power of love. End of quotes. Consider that the earth, and this is an indigenous way of thinking. Consider that the earth is and the animals and the plants are not a resource, but they are your relative. They are your relatives, not a resource to be used or profited from. And to have a relationship with your family. Trying to get to my next slide. And the next slide is, as you connect in with your love of the creation, what are your joyous connections to earth and the creation? Where are you? What are you doing when you feel the most joy for the creation? And whether you, I didn't want to, like, what do you call it, give you subliminal messages, so you can have your eyes open, because you might think I'm all not correct on some of this. But I'm going to give you some examples that you might consider. How about when you're choosing to drive an energy-efficient vehicle, that you celebrate that you are walking gently on the earth, having a low carbon footprint? Or when you choose to mow your lawn with, I don't know, goats? I'm really going out on a limb here now. Or with an electric lawnmower. We had all these community first credit card points, so I said, let's buy an electric lawnmower. And so that's what we have. Or hanging your clothes on the line instead of putting them in the dryer, which there's no way a hot clothes dryer is energy efficient. Oh, so I know some covenants in some neighborhoods don't allow you to even hang clothes on the line. I'm like, really? Enjoy getting grounded, making your own compost, your own good dirt. Here in the reception area, I brought in my new homemade compost maker so you could take a look at it. It's I went to Menards and I got 3 milk crates and then a hot glue gun and the weed barrier and just cut it and glued it in. It's so easy. The last thing it needs though is a lid, so Tom's going to have to help me make a lid. Planting. Oh, Fred has offered to help create a garden for us out here on our property. But watching things grow, or helping at a community garden. Hiking, of course, in the forests and along rivers and lakes, and try to not be thinking, but try to be tuning into the senses, your sensory experience of all that you see, hear, smell, taste, and touch. That means probably not maybe even talking with a friend, but just being in the environment. How about stargazing? So I am on the war path against light pollution. And in my little compost bin back there, you can look at the light pollution that we have in our country and in our area and consider. You want to know where you can see some nice stars? Would have been back in 1970 in Winneconne on my farm. But now I drive up to Newport State Park, which is a dark sky designated park. So go there. I dragged Mary up there. We were scared. We didn't have any light. When you go, you need a flashlight with a red cellophane over the end. And it's good to get there before it's 11 o'clock at night and pitch black. Mary, she never went with me again. spot. I know I get there during the daylight and I get my blanket and I get my spot. Read love poems about the earth. Watch a sunrise, sunset. Lie on a beach. Float on the water. Feel the earth supporting you. Here's one for all of us campfire people. Protect the forest from infestations. Buy firewood where you burn it. Don't take your firewood and then bring it up to Leona, because you'll notice that the ash trees are getting infested, and you'll see all of a sudden this area of deforestation, of, you know, the leaves, the trees dying. Well, those bugs don't get there. You know how they got there. Somebody brought their firewood there. So this is simple little things that you'll feel your own selfishness come up, like, yeah, but I got this and I don't want to buy it someplace else. It's like, well, get over it. Oh, geez. Okay. And then your food that you eat. Celebrate when you choose to savor every bite. And buy local foods so that you're more of the time, some of the time. And buy foods that the animals have been raised in a way with respect. And I'm running short on time, so I better stop. I'm going to move along here. Yeah, you get me up here and you can't get rid of me. And the good news, hey, our government actually did something I think was good, was in April 2022, they signed into law National Native Plant Month. Thank you very much. And so I'm going to read one last poem by Wendell Berry. The Peace of Wild Things. Wendell Berry is a farmer, an ecologist, an environmentalist, an who advocates for all these environmental things. The Peace of Wild Things. When despair for the world grows in me and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my life and my children's lives may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water and I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting with their light. For a time I rest in the grace of the world and am free. Thank you, Wendell Berry. And one last thing, I want to introduce you. I am a foster mother. In October, this is a little red oak. And in October, hiking at Navarino Hills Nature Center, I picked up some acorns, 5 acorns. And I learned that you have to stratify them. In other words, they have to be in the cold for about 5 months. So I got a plastic Ziploc bag, put some potting soil in there, got it moist, buried my little acorns, and then I'll put them in the back of the refrigerator, where many things get forgotten and lost forever. Fortunately, March came along and I remembered and pulled them out and I looked and a couple were sprouting. And I went on YouTube and learned what to do, and so I planted it. It's been so much fun watching this little red oak grow. And they grow fast. They grow up 2 feet a year. And maybe it's going to have a home here in our property. We'll see. It's yet to be determined. And I got 4 white oak saplings last week, I think it was, on Sunday, from Sarah, my daughter, for Earth Day. And gave one to John and Carrie, and they've planted in their yard. 50 years from now, it will have acorn babies and Cindy. And then 2 went into my niece Lisa Nett's woods. So that's it. That's all I got. Thank you.
I now invite you, thank you, Linda, by the way. I now invite you to begin to prepare yourself for a personal, reflective personal prayer and guided musical meditation, after which I ask that you remain in essential silence during the music. If you choose to, you may close your eyes. Feel the weight of your body as it relaxes into your chair and you let go of today's anxieties. Feel your feet on the solid earth beneath as you let go of tomorrow's worries. Become aware in this moment of your breathing. As you breathe in life and breathe out love. Breathe in life and breathe out love. And as you become centered, focus your attention on your beautiful heart. Your beautiful Christ self, and become filled with gratitude. And allow into yourself that which fills you with peace and light. And so we begin. And now I invite you to gently return to this place.
Breaking the silence. Now we move from meditation to our affirmation of prosperity. This is the time in our service when those of us who think of Unity of Appleton as our spiritual home practice putting spirit first in our financial life. We know that when we do this, not only does it prosper our spiritual community that we love, It also supports our own spiritual growth and prosperity. Let this be a time to connect with the guidance of Spirit in you and give whatever amount Spirit guides you to give. Whatever that amount is this morning, take it in your hand and bless it with your love. If you are one of the growing number of us who give electronically, take this gift into your heart. Feel free to bless the plate as it passes by. Let yourself feel as grateful as you can to God in you as your one source. Then please join in our affirmation of prosperity. And together we will affirm our prosperity. Unity of Appleton is alive with a unity spirit in the flow of divine abundance and radiant with unlimited possibilities. And one of my favorite parts of the service, with me. Divine love in and through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I joyfully give and willingly receive. I give in love, and I trust God as my source. More music and passing the plate.
First song, who hummed the first tune? Was it the wind blowing past the moon? Were the stars making noise as they sparkled at night? Did the sun sing a song as it colored the sky?
Oh, sing, 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 sing.
Did the waves make a song as they crashed to the shore? Or was it the whales or the lion's first roar? The first flowers hum as they burst into bloom. Or was the first song when the thunder went boom?
Sing, sing, sing. Sing, sing, sing. Sing, sing, sing. Sing, sing, sing.
Maybe elephants running loud over the ground. Or maybe the birds. Guesses we've made are quite good, but they're wrong. It was God's creator who sang the first song.
When we began, God decided to sing, and God sang a song for everything. God's song says you're good, you are wonderfully made, and you'll never stop being loved all of your days. So sing, sing.
The Creator knew all along that every heart and everything was born with a song and began to
sing, 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 sing.
When we began, God decided to sing. Song for everything. When we began, God decided to sing, and God sang a song
now for our announcements. As we hold the Ukrainian people in our hearts and prayers, we open to help in other ways. We're collecting monetary donations for Wisconsin Ukrainians, Inc., which provides goods to refugees. A donation basket is on the greeter table. Please sign up at the Connect and Serve table to make coffee. Takes just a few minutes of your morning, and thanks to the Way of a Heart group for volunteering to clean up after our coffee time. Are there more announcements? Yeah. I, Emily, have graciously volunteered to host dessert and conversation at my house next Saturday evening, when we will be getting ready to hear Tom Wendt give the service talk and conversation after that again. Tom Wendt has been affiliated in one way or another with Unity for, I'll say, decades, ever since I've known Unity here in Appleton. He has a great love for us. He has supported us financially. He has served as a mentor to past ministers that we have had. So his devotion to our community is really profound. And I know that our conversation on Saturday night will be meaningful to you. He's eager to know just what's going on here and how he can further support our growth and our place in our community. So 7 o'clock, till who knows when, really, at my house. Address is up there. Jot it down. Please RSVP so I know how many chairs I need to provide and how much dessert I need to make. If you can carpool, Linda has volunteered to offer rides, as has Louise, I think. Or Carrie and Karen and Steve also, you can speak with them. I do live in a condo, so parking space is limited, but there is lots of space across the street from my condo, which is at the Ascension Mercy Hospital on West 9th Avenue. So if you get there and you don't see a place to park, feel free to park across there. But that time of the night, traffic shouldn't be all that great, okay? Really hope that you can come. Our Saturday morning group that has met now since almost the first of the year has found it so important to meet casually in conversation, to share what's on our hearts, the hope that we have for unity, for ourselves in unity. It's another way of expanding the love that we have for each other, for the growth and the support of our community, for ourselves, and as we all recognize, for the world at large. So that's that. If you or a close contact is ill with an upper respiratory infection, please stay home. Join us Sunday morning on YouTube, Unity of Appleton Live. CDC is recommending isolation for 5 days from onset of symptoms. Masks are optional and they are available should you desire them. Mark your calendars. Oh, lots of things going on here. And I have to read it from here. Our next workshop with Reverend Phil Smedstead will be Honoring Our Past and Creating Our Future on Saturday, May 21st from 10 to 4, with a potluck lunch included. Everyone in our spiritual community is urged to attend this important congregational process. And that includes all of you on Facebook listening to us right now. We really do treasure your attendance, whether it's in person here or on Facebook. If you're regular Facebook followers, We want to get to know you. We really do. Everyone in our spiritual community, is urged to attend this important congregational process. This meeting is an opportunity for each of us to participate in telling the story of our ministry and understand how past events and issues are linked to our future success as a group. As we look toward our future, we need to embrace our past as a means of rediscovering who we are as a cohesive and principle-based community. Please make an effort to participate in this important event that will sow the seeds to grow a positive future. And please bring something in a dish to share for lunch. No matter how pretty the dish is, we want something in it. Okay, anything more, Steve? Angie? Okay, so then our prayer for protection. Please stand. And exuberantly declare that the light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.
And now you can exuberantly sing along with us.
Good.
Unity of Appleton, it is our place, a home where we love and learn and sing. When we get together, it's the love in our hearts that sees beauty everywhere in everything. Oh, bloody, oh, blood, life is love, yeah. La, 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 life is love. Oh, bloody, oh, blood, life is love. Grace, there is no limit to what each of us can do. Oh, bloody, oh, blood, life is love, yeah. La, 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 life is love. Oh, bloody, oh, blood, life is love, yeah. La, 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 life is love. And if you know that life is love, then it's oh, bloody, blood,